back against people who wanted to get a third-party vendors for apps on the iPhone. Tell us about it.
Yeah, you know, Steve Jobs knew how to listen to people, and he was very stubborn at times. He created the iPod and then, of course, the iPhone, and he wanted end-to-end control. So he didn't allow people, other companies, to put apps on the iPhone. But his board kept pushing back on him, and finally he says, hey, if you guys think you're so smart, just, and he used a few four-letter words, go ahead and do it. And that was his way of showing that he listened to people. They used to give
an award at Apple
to the person who best stood up to Steve Jobs. And the first 4 years, it was won by women, which was cool. Andy, four women, Joanne Hoffman, won it. But the cool thing was that when Steve found out about it, he didn't get mad. All four of them got promoted. So I think you have to be able to have people pushing back and listening. And finally, you got to create a great team. Like my friend Annette said, Steve Jobs, when I asked him once, what was the greatest product you ever did?
He said, well, creating a product is hard, but
what's really hard is creating a team that will continually make
great products. The best thing I did
was to create the team at Apple.
Annette, can you think of a president that stands out in your mind that created that sort of thing?
Well, most notably, the team of rivals concept. I think that Bill Clinton had a team. Now, he went through a very controversial presidency. He had sort of a different model there. But anyone who brings together people who are forceful, people who are creative, and, as Walter said, people who are willing to, a person willing to listen.
If you have to get
a great team, but if you don't have the personality that allows you to change and to be flexible, it's not going to matter. I think the important thing for President Biden now is to find people that he's comfortable with. This is an
incredibly long time
in the country, and it's not. I mean, I like the idea of contention and all of, but this is a moment for healing and a moment for confidence. And he needs to surround himself with people that he
trusts, and that's key.
Mm-hmm. You know, Walter. Speaking of Bill Clinton, it's interesting how the first few years of Bill Clinton's presidency, he followed the JFK model. I remember reading in Richard Reeves' wonderful biography about JFK that Ike kept telling him, it's a pyramid. You're at the top of that pyramid, and if a problem gets to you, it better be a big problem. Whereas Kennedy saw himself in the middle of a circle with all the arrows pointing to him, and he had incoming coming at him all the time. Bill Clinton started that way, but he didn't end that way. And you could argue he became more effective when he went more to the sort of Ike pyramid approach. Do you have an opinion on presidencies, how they're most effectively organized?
I think it's very hard to do the pyramid top-down hierarchical approach in the digital age, where power is so much decentralized, whether it be power within your own team or power in the United States. You can't have hierarchies that easy with the type of digital transmission of information we have. I agree with Annette totally that as much as I love David Ignatius, my favorite columnist in many ways, I think that before he gets to contention and bold people, the Biden administration, he really does
have to calm
things down in comfort. We talked about Doris Kearn saying Lincoln had a team of rivals. Well, Biden has a team of buddies, and that may seem a little problematic when people think we need bold initiatives, but at the moment, we need people who are trusted by the president, who can comfort us, and who can exude some competence. So I would like that cooling off period that I think Biden is bringing.
Hey, Walter, I'm going to ask you about America doing big things, because we just did a big thing.
And with some help from the
German company BioNTech, you write about people like Steve Jobs and Ben Franklin and Leonardo da Vinci as well. America, in partnership with another country, in this case in Germany,
but also American
Moderna is an American firm as well, just developed and got FDA approval for the first of hopefully several vaccines in less than a year.
It was a combination of doctors
and scientists and government and pharmaceutical companies. What does that tell you about America right now? Because there has been so much cynicism and despair around what's happening right now.
It's a great achievement. It's a great achievement for innovation. It's a great achievement for alliances like we had.
Pfizer and BioNTech, a German and an American company. And I think one of the important things
lot of institutions
that invested in basic science. And when you look at what BioNTech, Pfizer has done and Moderna has done, it's a whole new type of vaccine that comes out of the most basic thing in the entire planet Earth when it comes to science, which is the secret of life, how RNA creates protein in our cells. And that's all that thing, all that vaccine does, is it takes a piece of RNA and says, create this protein that'll give immunity to coronavirus. So we have to look at a country that has, since World War II, America, been very good at incenting basic science, and we have to realize that we're moving into a new revolution. Since the end of World War II, we were in a digital revolution based on bits and microchips and on-off switches that could process information. Now we're in a molecular revolution where molecules are the new microchip, and that's going to take a greater combination of government, industry, and academia, because creating a vaccine is not something you can do in your dorm room or a garage or a garret like the Google guys or the Facebook guys did.
Right.
So, Annette,
can you answer the $64,000 question that seems to be hanging over any talk I give or any interview I give? Everybody asks, how should Joe Biden approach Mitch McConnell in the Republican Congress? And they use the example of Barack Obama going in and being effectively shut down by Republicans, determined to do little more than end his presidency after one term. What should Joe Biden do, looking back at that history that he was very much a part of?
Well, his inclination, it seems, is to be bipartisan. I mean, he loves the Senate to work with people as much as possible. But that doesn't really bode well. My advice to him, and I'm not the president, obviously, would be to use whatever powers he has to do what it takes. We have things to do in the country, and we don't have time for games. And whatever power he can use, making people acting secretaries, whatever he can do to get the ball rolling, I think he should do. Make the overture that they are rebuffed. Don't spend the next 4 years begging. Do what he can and use the power of the president.